For the SBS studios in Artarmon, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land I'm recording from. I pay my respects to the Cammeraygal people of the Gurungai Nation and their elders past and present. I also acknowledge the traditional owners from all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander lands you are listening from.
Hi, I'm Suraj Kolarkar. Welcome back for another season of My First Year in Oz, where we dive into immigrant stories of coming to Australia. Our guest today is Indira Naidoo, of Indian South African descent. Indira has been a pioneer in Australian media, and today we explore her immigrant journey.
Welcome, everyone. On today's episode, we have a very special guest, the wonderful Indira Naidoo. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you very much for the invitation, Suraj.
I'm very excited.
Me too.
Let's start in the beginning. Tell me, where were you born?
So I was born in Pietermaritzburg in Natal in South Africa in 1968. So that was a really momentous year, not because I was born. But also because of that. But lots of amazing things, you know, happened in the world in that year. And I always go back, you know, and think, wow, not that I was aware of it, obviously, then, but, you know, the Beatles were going crazy. JFK was in the White House. You know, men were walking on the moon and all this sort of stuff was going on. And there's little old me. Little Indian girl born in a little hospital in Pietermaritzburg, South Africa. So I always think of 1968 as quite a special year for me to have been brought into the world.
Yeah. Take me back to childhood in South Africa. How long were you there? What was it like?
Yeah, so not long. My parents are fifth generation South African Indians, and their forefathers had come to South Africa from India in the 1840s. So they'd been brought to South Africa as indentured labourers to work on the sugar cane plantations in Natal. And like so many indentured labourers around that time, there was a massive migration. They were all promised you'll be able to save and have your house and have an education, all the things that in the poor village that their forefathers were from, they couldn't have had that possibility. And of course, South Africa was never going to be that sort of place. And they quickly realised that they would be thrown into basically become indentured labourers, and everything they owned was really owned by the people who owned the plantation. So they were just a step up, really, from being slaves. And they became very aware of that colour code too, you know. So they may have had problems with caste systems and religious problems in India, but then when they went to South Africa, they realised, oh my gosh, it was paradise compared to what South Africa was to become. And then, of course, that system of racial hierarchy then developed into apartheid, and that then restricted and limited all the outcomes for any person of colour in South Africa, really. So my parents were the first generation in their family to have the opportunity to get an education, which meant leaving South Africa because non-white people couldn't go to university. So they were sent to India to study. So interesting, really, in a way, isn't it? This country you're escaping to find a new life, and then that new country is sending you back for opportunities for education. So
yeah.
So they went back to South Africa, to India, and then realised that there was this extraordinary world, even though India obviously had its challenges then and still does today. For them, it was so good to be in a country where being Indian wasn't going to limit your opportunities necessarily. So when they came back with their qualifications, they realised that, you know, they weren't going to be employed as dentists and teachers because there weren't any non-white dentists at the time in Pietermaritzburg. So they made this very difficult decision to leave their family, leave everything they knew, and leave South Africa. And why it was a doubly big decision, it wasn't just what most migrants go through, but it was this combination of being an economic migrant, but also a migrant that didn't really have a choice. You had to leave these circumstances. And one of the really difficult things was the way the South African government at the time controlled people and races was with passes, and you had to carry, and that would allow you to go from suburb to suburb or school or shop, and you could be asked to show your pass at any time if you were a non-white person. And they also controlled your movement by limiting, not giving these passes to your children. So it meant you had to stay in South Africa. So it was a way to control you, make sure you couldn't leave the country either. So what my father did was he decided he was going to try to smuggle. I'd just been born. I was just over a year and a half, 18 months old, smuggle me out of the country. That was the only way that they were going to be able to leave the country, to smuggle me out, because there was no legal way at the time to take me out. So they got in their car. They put me in the back of the car, covered me in blankets. And when they came up to the border with the southern Rhodesian at the time, which is now Zimbabwe border, to cross to go to Zambia, they knew they were going to, you know, hit the border guards, and that they'd be allowed, because that was still seen as part of South Africa, southern Rhodesia. But they knew if the guards found me, they would be in trouble and probably jailed. So Mum had fed me just before we came close to the border, made sure that I was, you know, as sleepy as she could make me without drugging me. Maybe she should have drugged me. And then covered me in these blankets, and then just prayed that I wasn't going to make any noise in any goo-gahs or anything. And apparently when the guard came to the front door and checked all their passes and all their passports and things, that was fine. And then he wondered, what are all these blankets? And they said, oh, you know, we're going to stay at friends and we've taken all our pillows and blankets with us. And so they opened the back door, and with the rifle butt, they poked the blanket
to make
sure there was no body or someone underneath the blankets. And Mum was absolutely certain that they'd poke me and that would wake me up and I'd start crying. But miracle upon miracle, it didn't happen. I stayed quiet, stayed asleep, and they didn't find the baby under the blankets, and they let the car go. And that was how I left South Africa. So I actually left illegally.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
That's such a good story. And she tells it so well. Every time I talk, I feel like the show gets worse.
Not at all.
Every time she talks, it gets better.
You can chart it.
Oh, my goodness. That's so fascinating.
So I often sort of think that was a very auspicious way for me. That was my first travel experience.
That
was how it happened. And I guess it wasn't surprising in a way then that every other step then of a very over-adventurous life that we then led, it just seemed very normal to me, because that was the way it began. So my second sister was born in Zambia, and then we left Zambia because the copper price had fallen out of the market, and my father was employed as a dentist by the government there. And England at the time in the early 70s was seen by lots of immigrants all over the world as, you know, the land of milk and honey. So we joined that wave of immigrants coming from the subcontinent and Eastern Europe, and we came from Africa and we landed in England, again through Liverpool. And the Beatles had just, you know, finished off there. But Liverpool was such an exciting, that's where we based ourselves when we first arrived. Very, very exciting time for a little kid. I was, you know, again, only about three. And my job was to walk down the flight of stairs to pick up the milk bottle that was left on the doorstop every day and then walk up the stairs. And I'd walk out, and I still remember as a little kid, and there was a huge youth population in Liverpool at the time. And the Beatles had really driven a lot of anti-establishment feeling. People didn't like authority in the government at the time, and so there were fights and there were fires in bins, and little toddler, I'd sit there on the stoop sometimes, and Mum would say I'd open the milk bottle and I'd drink the milk while I was watching all of this and forget to go up and bring the milk, you know, for their cup of tea or their cereal. And I used to just love the theatre of watching all these older kids, and what were they fighting at, and they're throwing stones and rocks and things. And then when you go back as a journalist and you look back at that time, and I realise some of the historic riots, I was sitting there on that door stoop, you know, watching this sort of unfold on the streets. And the Beatles had begun a lot of this, you know, questioning of authority. And then with the influx of immigrants all coming through the port of Liverpool, that had also added to poverty, discrimination, a whole lot of things. It wasn't a great place to be. We moved to London. My third sister was born there. And again, discrimination. My parents' qualifications weren't recognised by the British government, so my father had to resit the last 3 years of his dental degree with three children, so it was very difficult financially. And Gough Whitlam came to power in Australia about the time, since 1972. And my parents said, this guy sounds really interesting. He was saying unusual things for the time. He was saying, we just want you to come to our country. We'll give you a job. We'll give you a house. We welcome everyone from any culture, any race. And my parents had a choice to either go to Canada or Australia, and there was something about Gough Whitlam and that It's Time campaign that really captivated them. And so we found ourselves on a plane with, I think, £50 to our name, all piled into this plane, heading for a tiny town on the east coast of Tasmania, of all places. That was where the government had found my father a dental school practice, a little town called St. Mary's. It had a population of about 300 people. And that's where this little Indian family landed in 1974, I think it was. And we all had strong English accents, almost Beatlesque as well.
Right,
mine was
right.
as well.
And how old were you then?
So I was six.
Right. Okay. And this time you got to travel in a seat. You
were in a real seat.
Hidden.
Yeah. No one was poking me with a rifle. And
it's always good.
And it was so funny because the kids at school had said, well, what's this Australia going to be like? And we'd heard that there's kangaroos jumping down the street and you can jump into their pouch and jump and hop with them down the street. You know, they had all these funny stories. And we kept saying, no, that's what people say. But it's a proper city, you know, with real houses and backyards. You're not going to find kangaroos. But the town of St. Mary's that we went to was right on the fringe of extreme, beautiful virgin bushland. And absolutely, Suraj, when we arrived, I was even shocked. There were wallabies jumping down the street. And I'm thinking, hang on, what is this place? That's not meant to be true. And that was really when I fell in love with wildlife and nature. We had wallabies around us, wombats. We saw the sorts of nature that Australian kids growing up in, as they do, in suburban cities, just never, ever see. As we'd walk to our school, our country primary school, all these wildlife would follow us as we went down the sort of dirt track. And I thought that was how all Aussie kids grew up in Australia. I had no idea that we were having the experience even people born in Australia will never experience.
Yeah, like a Pied Piper kind of situation.
It was like that. Yeah, yeah. Dot and the Kangaroo, there was a famous book that we all grew up with in the 70s, and that was what it absolutely was like. You'd see kookaburras in the trees and the possums would jump down. And, it was the gum trees, the bush rock. I think that was when I realized that even though I was six and we'd already done a bit of traveling, I'd found where I wanted to stay. I'd found Australia and this is the place that I really wanted to stay.
Wonderful. I remember exactly from me being 11 and moving to Australia as well, being fascinated by the wildlife, because beyond the kangaroos as well, as you said, you know, we've got wombats, we've got koalas, we've got all this kind of wildlife that's so different to everywhere else in the world. I remember seeing the koala bridges mm-hmm. on top of the highways.
Yeah, yeah.
And thinking that must be quite a trip for a koala to make.
Oh, yeah.
Like this thing just, you know, sits around in the woods eating eucalyptus just high all the time. And now it's crossing a 7-lane highway with metal bullets just going at 100 k's an hour under it. That must be quite an adventure for it.
I know. And they actually work.
Yeah,
yeah.
I can't believe they used them.
I know. I'd feel claustrophobic if I was going to try that.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, when it comes to wildlife and that Australian bush and I'm always interested in this about immigration and migration because people would just assume where you were born is your home and that's where you sort of will always have the longing to be or go to. And some people even further than that, you know, would say that your forefathers, if they're from India, that there'd be a calling and a connection. And even though, you know, I feel bad, I've never been to India, which I should have by this stage. I'll correct that soon. And South Africa and Africa definitely has a calling for me. But I'm so lucky how it was, I think, so impossible that my parents ever came to Australia. I mean, I would never have stumbled across that, you know, probably on my own. And I think I found my home, but it was sort of so many homes down the track. You know,
yeah.
So
yeah.
It's so interesting.
Yeah. And it's like the last place that allowed your dad to still be a dentist. Everywhere else, they're like, all right, got 12 years experience doing dentistry. Yeah, not here. You're not doing. And then he goes to England. Like, nope, not here either.
Yeah.
Learn it again. And here they went, okay, yeah, I think you can do it.
Yeah. I mean, we certainly thought we'd found paradise. And the way we were embraced by that country town, again, was not like other immigrant experiences. Certainly all my friends and family have never had this experience. We were rock stars. It just so happened in that little country town, they'd had very little immigration from, they'd had some Polish people come to work in the coal mine and some Czechoslovakians. But basically, the indigenous community, they had moved out, or, you know, they'd obviously been their own local genocides there, the Tasmanian Aborigines. And so there hadn't been a lot of contact with anyone that wasn't white, you know, for a couple of generations of this town. And so and this was also before television was really, you know, very broad. I mean, it was 1972-3. There was black and white television. It wasn't even colour yet. Most people didn't watch a lot of television. So there weren't a lot of negative images associated with migrants or immigrants or people from, you know, look different. And so for that town, they just really wanted a dentist. They hadn't had a dentist for quite a while. So they were just excited to have a dentist. And so we were treated like rock stars. The kids wanted to sit next to us in class. My mum and us were invited round for afternoon teas, cucumber sandwiches and, you know, fairy bread and all those Australian things. And we honestly thought that was just the way new arrivals were treated in Australia. You know, and I just thought, oh, these are great people, you know, because we weren't treated like this in other parts of Africa or in England, but Australia must be like this. And it wasn't until very later in my life, you know, because we went after Tasmania, we went back to Africa and then we came back, that I realised, no, we had a very unusual experience, and that I'm yet to meet another immigrant who even tells that story.
Yeah, I was going to say, of all the episodes we have done, I think that is the polar opposite initial experience. And I guess, you know, congratulations on finding that pocket of, you know, goodwill at the right time. As you said, it was, you know, like culturally influenced as well. There weren't the images online of hate and discrimination, which was kind of spreading through people. And so it was kind of like the perfect time and place for that to happen.
And what happened to Suraj because of that? Because the other thing that I'm very conscious of is that I don't interact with people quite the same way a lot of other people do. So my cousins will often say, you know, if we've gone to someone's house, and they'll say, do you know that we were the only Indian people in that room? And I'll go, no, I didn't notice at all. What do you mean? Why would you notice that? And they go, you always notice that because we're always in the minority. Don't you notice how many brown people? Don't you count them? Oh, I'm the only one. Well, there's two others in the room.
Okay. Yeah.
Don't notice it ever. And they said, that's not possible. And I say, maybe it's because of the way that wasn't made, you know, I wasn't made to feel that.
Yeah.
You know, that wasn't the reason, you know, I was embraced and welcomed in rooms, and I never felt different. And if anything, I was always made to feel that that was a better thing to be. So to have brown skin, people would go, oh, your skin's so beautiful and brown, and, oh, can I touch your skin? And people wanted to touch our skin. And again, now obviously as an adult, you know that just never happens. That's just quite bizarre. But as you said, if it happens at the right time for a child, that positivity stays with you for the rest of your life. And I honestly feel like no one can ever make me feel bad about the colour of my skin or anything about being different. Like, I've always seen it as a positive, but I also understand how unique and how unusual. And so I owe a great depth of gratitude to those that, you know, those people in St. Mary's that gave our family that sense of being welcomed.
Wonderful. Yeah. I literally, you just reminded me of the last wedding I went to. I attended a friend's wedding. I was the only brown person in the whole wedding. There's like 50 white people. Even my wife is white. And so I'm the only guy. And I'm like, is this the remake of the movie Get Out? Like, what's happening? Yeah. Is it happening again? And so when you mentioned that, I was like, I remember standing there going, wow, we're on a farm and it's 50 white people and it's just me.
Yeah.
But I guess I noticed that more because I didn't have that kind of initial experience that you might have, right? That's fascinating. Have you been back to that town?
I have.
Okay.
I have, and it's a very different town now.
Yeah, I was going to say, do you want to avoid going back there because it was such a perfect memory, but you have been back.
I have been back, and it's changed. The demographics of that town have changed. The coal mine closed down. The people who moved in didn't necessarily share the same values of the people that were there before. It doesn't have the same vibe that it feels like a lot of small country towns where an outsider is viewed suspiciously. You know, that was the way that I even felt when I was going through. And sadly, that does tend to be, you know, the sort of more the norm with most towns. But
they've got only white dentists now. We've heard. I don't know.
They still talk about actually my father as being one of the best dentists that they had.
There you go. There.
So, yeah, a few people were still in the town who remembered that. But I think also because I grew up Indian, but in South Africa, surrounded by majority of Africans. And then a large part of my life in Australia, where a majority of people are white, that does do really interesting things with your head, because as you're forming your own identity, all the parameters keep changing.
Right.
So you're in South Africa and they tell you you're brown skinned, you're Indian and you're a girl, you know, your life's going to be shit. You know, that's it. You know, you've got you can't contribute to society, that you've born on the lowest rung you can possibly go. And then you're in a migrant family and we're all three girls. So even though culturally, if I'd been a girl with brothers, maybe I would have felt different. And also being the eldest is different as well. And so everything then made me think, hey, I can do everything that a boy could do, because I had to change the oil on the car and help my father because he didn't have any sons.
Right.
And in an Indian family, would I have done that if there'd been an older brother, you know? Probably not, you know?
I can't change the oil in the car, and I'm an only child. That's why my dad's walking everywhere. He's like, please change the oil. I'm like, I don't know how.
There you go. Yeah. Your dad needs to call me, Suraj.
Yeah, yeah. He can call you.
The son he always wanted. That's
right.
Me.
He's like, she's finally here. Thank goodness. You're in overalls.
Yeah. And again, I think that was just chance and luck. And so I grew up very differently to my girl cousins who didn't have that experience. They were expected to learn how to make the roti and, you know, all that sort of stuff, which we sort of had to do as well. But it was just like you did all the jobs that needed to be done. And then when we were in Africa.
It's so hard to get them around, by the way.
It's really hard.
Yeah.
It's the technique. You keep got to keep moving the roti around.
You got to knead it in the right way. Yeah. Otherwise, it ends up in this oblong shape. Yeah. You think, I've failed at this as well.
So I've got to teach you how to change the oil and also make roti.
Yeah. Okay. So weirdly, I'm closer to a rounder roti than the oil change.
The oil.
Gotta get it together here.
And then when we were in Africa, the Shona people that we went to school with and got to know in Zimbabwe, they are a matriarchal society. So the woman is the head of the household, not in the traditional Indian society. And so that was another model that, you know, so they got very excited when they'd see my father and my mother his father particularly, with three daughters. And in Indian culture, they have dowry. In African Shona culture, they have lobolo, which is you've got to give goats to the father for their hand of the daughter.
Right.
So it's not it's the other way around. So everywhere we'd go in Africa would be, oh, you're so lucky you've got daughters. And that wasn't the way my father and my mother had grown up. It was the opposite, you know, in Indian culture.
Yeah.
So that then turns everything on its head another way. And then also in African culture, you know, women who are, you got curvy figures are desirable. Skinny women, no one wants to marry those women at all. And so then as teenagers, we developed a love of our curvy bodies. And then you go into Australian society back again. It's all skinny white women, you know, that are held up as the ideal. And so what that does to you, if you realise that the way you are, you should just accept the way you are, because every city or culture or society you're going to be in is going to keep on judging you for this and think speaking like that is good, looking like that is good, having this colour skin is good. And every culture does it.
Yeah.
And so if you keep trying to adjust and adapt to whatever, it's pointless.
Yeah, you're kind of chasing the dragon of something that's constantly changing between different parts of the world.
And what happens with most migrants, they usually just have one experience of migration.
Yeah.
And so then they're stuck in that and they don't ever really get a chance to leave that and then go to another experience that challenges that norm that they've been exposed to. And so I think that was also what was lucky for us, is that leaving Australia then going back to Africa, I think if we'd stayed and as teenage girls, we would have grown up with that idea that you have to be fair-skinned and suntan and, you know, blonde-haired. But then being thrown to Africa when we're going through puberty in our teen years, it's everyone's really dark-skinned, and the blacker the skin that you have, the more desirable you are and the more attractive. And so I think that was also a very important thing that helped particularly with me, I think, because I went there as a teenager back to Africa.
Yeah, I was going to say, what age did you go back?
Yeah, 13.
Okay, so and from 6 to 13.
In Tasmania.
Yeah, and then back to Africa. Which part of Africa?
Zimbabwe.
Oh, okay, right.
Yeah, so they just got independence, and my father wanted to go back and help rebuild the country. He'd been very close to the freedom movement of South Africa and thought, at least I'm on the border now, and this will hopefully be the next domino to fall will be South Africa. And unfortunately, Zimbabwe didn't hold up to what our aspirations were. There was Robert Mugabe, who was a despot, who came to power. And we only lived there for 3 years before we left and came back to Australia. But in those 3 years, it was wild. I mean, yeah. Zimbabwe was still at the end of its civil war. So wow. As 13-year-olds, tanks were going through our school in Zimbabwe. And we'd come from a very settled, secure middle life, you know, middle class life in Tasmania.
Yeah.
So suddenly it's like, oh my gosh, you know, real poverty we saw for the first time as kids. My parents had been exposed to it, but we really hadn't been. And then, you know, the crisis, you know, there were people being killed, there were tanks, kidnappings, all this crazy lawlessness that suddenly you just went, oh, hang on.
Yeah.
What the hell? Where our parents brought us to?
And your dad said, let's just give it 3 years. Let's see how it goes. Let's give it nearly an Olympic term. And then we'll. Why 3 years? Why did you hang around when such craziness was happening?
I think they loved being back in Africa. And this is the thing about when you may have seen your parents return to their childhood and their place of where they feel they're from. And that was what my parents felt being back there. You know, as much as they appreciated all the advantages and the wonderful parts of Australia, there is the smell of hibiscus, bougainvillea and frangipani and, you know, that African air and the African animals, you know, driving between towns and giraffes just running down the side of the road next to your car. Like,
yes, giraffes.
Giraffes.
Wow.
And as kids, you're going, hang on, that just happens in picture books. But no, this is real Africa, you know. It's edgy. It makes you feel very alive and very grateful, you know, because there are days when they might not have electricity, days where you don't have water.
Yeah.
That's a very natural way to be in lots of even well-to-do parts of Africa. And we didn't have any experience of that in Australia. So yeah, it was exciting. It was a real adventure. And again, as kids, you don't really understand how unsettling and how dangerous it actually is.
Right. So you're kind of, by the innocence of youth, you're kind of shielded from the actual hectic craziness that was going around.
Yeah.
And you were just kind of, oh, this is a new adventure. We're in a different land.
Yeah. And then suddenly the Indians were being targeted. There were suspicions directed at, why would you come from Australia here? You must be a spy for the South African regime. You know,
right.
A whole lot of stuff like that was going on. Lots of different races were being targeted and different tribal groups, the Indibeles. And, so when we fled, we literally did. We left everything, furniture, money and bank accounts.
Oh, wow.
If you got to leave, we were lucky. We had an Australian passport. A lot of our friends in Zimbabwe didn't. And, yeah, we got to leave and come back to Australia. So I look back and realize just how lucky we were that we survived and we got out, because there weren't so many good stories from a lot of people from those times.
The second great escape.
Yeah.
There you go. You keep putting yourself in there and seeing, let's see if we can escape again. That's fascinating. So then which part of Australia did you go to?
To South Australia.
Right.
Yeah.
Like Adelaide area.
Well, Dad found a dental job in a little country town south of Adelaide called Narracourt, right, which is also tiny, like St. Mary's. And so we came literally from Civil War Africa, Zimbabwe, into this tiny country town, right in the middle of farming land,
no
wineries.
Tanks.
Yeah.
Very few tanks.
Very few tanks.
Yeah, yeah.
And the kids just could not relate to anything that we'd experienced. We couldn't relate to their life, you know, just driving around, you know, on a tractor instead of a tank. You know, and the ambitions also of the town and the kids were sort of not like us. Every minute for us was, okay, we have to study hard and get qualifications, which is very Indian. But also we had seen through our travels that there was things to do, like things to fix and things to address, and there was discrimination that, you know, needed to tell these stories. And these kids just wanted to go out and have a drink at the pub, you know? What's wrong with that?
Yeah.
So it was a real culture shock, I have to admit. I was 16, so that was not a good time to be thrown in and out of my network of friends and what I knew. So I got through year 12 and thought, okay, getting out of this place, and went to university in Adelaide. And that's where I studied journalism and started with the ABC, got an ABC cadetship and got into television at 21.
Wow, there you go.
Yeah.
We'll get to that in a moment, because yeah. I'm very keen to hear. I think your experiences as a person of color from back then, I imagine it was very different landscape to it is now.
I say I don't notice when if I'm the only brown person in a room, but I have to admit, journalism school, I was the only brown-skinned person in the whole of the university journalism course. I did notice that, because I thought that would have changed by then. And then when I got my cadetship at the ABC, again, I was the only brown-skinned, reporter in the newsroom. And so that was about, over 35 years ago now. Yeah. And sadly, in that 35 years, it hasn't really improved very much. I mean, ABC Radio, where I've recently been working, I was still the only brown-skinned person in the entire department. So right. That's 35 years from that.
Yeah.
We're in 2023.
Yeah. That's pretty disheartening. And you would think, with how perception, as we noticed from different cultures, there's different perception. You want as many angles as you want to cover a thing. If you're only shining a light from one direction at a thing nonstop, you're only seeing half of the picture.
Absolutely. Yeah, you're so right, Suraj. You've got to have diversity, not only the way people look, because obviously when they come from different cultural and religious backgrounds, they're bringing diversity. But I've also found it's important to have diversity of ideas. And if you're sitting in a room with a whole lot of brown people that are all Muslim or Hindu, you're all going to think alike as well. That's going to be a problem in itself as well. So it's the diversity of ideas that is so important that you get to by having people from different backgrounds, of course. And it's so vital for the media, because that is where we get a sense of who we are and what the challenges for our culture and our country are. So if the people telling those stories are not getting a diversity of views themselves, or come from a diversity of views, then we're going to get a poorer quality media. And unfortunately, that's what I've seen over the last 35 years. I've actually seen our media not only shrink in size, which we're all aware of, but shrink in the diversity of views that are expressed in that media as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's, concerning going forward on how that can be addressed, because you'd think over those 35 years, as we're seeing a push for diversity in a lot of other things, this is still not moved forward nearly at all.
And part of it is cultural. I'll spend time with families from different, ethnic backgrounds, and the challenge often when you arrive as a migrant family, you want to establish yourself and you want to be settled and you want to get money so you're safe and secure. And journalism is not going to be, or stand-up comedy is not necessarily going to be where you're going to go for that. Yeah. You want to go into being a doctor, or, hedge funds now is really where to get the money, right?
Yeah.
So people and immigrants will always chase money first to feel safe, and then the next generation will then go and be more supported to go and explore the arts and other areas. So that's what I'm always trying to encourage Indian families or ethnic families to think about, is that it's really powerful for you to encourage your children to go into communications and because that is actually the big barrier in setting up your life and being secure and welcomed and safe, is the way that is portrayed in the media. So if you've got your voice in the media, if your child is in the media, you're going to be able to have much more impact on the community in a lot of ways. Of course, it's important to have all those other people who are doctors and dentists and accountants and lawyers. But in terms of shaping our identity and what sort of culture and country we are, I mean, the media is so, so powerful. That's an important area for you to encourage your child to go into.
Absolutely. So what brought you towards your journalism degree? Because you were in Adelaide. You had just spent a few years in this country town. Your experiences from earlier in Tasmania to in Africa were so different and distinct, and culture shock after culture shock. Did that kind of shape the direction in which you wanted to go?
I hadn't really thought of journalism per se as a career, again, because I didn't see anyone in the media that looked like me, that I didn't think I could be the sort of person that could host a television show or a radio show or write a book or anything. But I knew I loved meeting people. I loved talking about ideas. I loved writing. And it sort of ticked most of those boxes. So I thought, oh, well, I'll throw in an application for journalism school and see what happens, you know. And I loved current affairs as well, you know, politics and news and things like that. So I think if I hadn't been accepted, I probably would have gone, okay, well, I'll just go and do law. Because I just wasn't passionate, because I just didn't think that was going to be something that I would be successful at or someone would recognize any ability. I was very lucky that first door actually opened for me, and so I walked through it, and then I was just lucky the doors just kept on opening, and in most ways it was actually quite a smooth transition compared to the stories, again, that I hear from people go, I get knocked back and I was discriminated because I had an accent and I looked like this and whatever. Part of it is obviously I've been lucky. I've got a typical Australian accent.
Yeah.
And I think that can be an inhibitor for some people when they hear someone who may even be Australian born but can have an accent from their immigrant background, and then people may think, oh, you know, people won't want to hear that accent.
Yeah.
So maybe that was the advantage. And also we were generally very westernized as a family, so I didn't wear saris. Maybe if I'd insisted on wearing the sari and I read the news, that would have been, you know, it would have been a statement, that's for sure. But yeah. Would I have been encouraged to do that, or would I have been felt, you know? So in a way, I was sort of lucky. I was sort of almost this westernized version of an immigrant person in the media. So maybe an acceptable face as well, an acceptable voice.
Yeah, yeah. You remind me of when I had just moved to Australia, and there were other brown kids who had grown up here who sounded Australian, who got along much better with a lot of the Australian kids. And here I had this thick Indian accent, and I'm going, man, I sound different even though I look the same as this other guy. And that immediately has put this kind of, you know, barrier. Yeah. So that's absolutely something that I think about as well.
Mm.
Yeah. Tell me, what was it like over the those 35 years? Did you feel initially any kind of discrimination, or did you feel that later, or was it more frustration at the fact that more people of color weren't invited in a similar kind of way?
You know, there's so many ways that you can feel included and accepted. And I tend to be, and I think because we moved around a lot and I had to adapt to a new environment constantly and be accepted and be included. And so I think my focus was always that. How do I fit in? How do I fit in? Because that's what I had to do. So I maybe did it more than I needed to, and I did it much more than most people would do it. And I'd almost beat everyone over the head with just being like the funnest kid to be around, and that, you know, hang out with me, and I can be whatever you need me to be, I think, without really being conscious that I was trying to not be me,
right.
But I was just trying to be, just get along, I guess. Mm. And so that probably helped me. I have that general personality anyway. So I, unlike maybe my other sisters who are a little bit shy, a little bit anti-authoritarian, a little bit, you know, don't, what do you mean, you know. So if someone's came up to me and said in the supermarket, you know, they thought it was a compliment. This old lady, when I first started reading the news in Adelaide, said, I just want to say, you speak so well. Where did you learn to speak English? Right? Now, my sister was with me and she got really pissed off and she wanted to like get stuck into this old lady. And I knew what she meant and I knew what she was intending, you know, to mean. But she didn't mean it to be insulting, even though it was. And so my job was to educate. So I said to her, actually, thank you, but English is the only language I speak fluently, and I've spoken it since, you know, the day I was born. And my parents each speak 7 languages each. She goes, really? You know, so I was explaining to them about Tamil and speaking Shona and Zulu and Afrikaans, and, you know, so I used that interaction in the aisle to explain and educate something to this woman who she didn't really, you know, didn't understand the broader thing. Whereas my sister was just inflamed and just really angry, and she goes, I can't believe you kept on talking to that old lady. and I think that that's part of my personality. So you can either choose to be annoyed or insulted, and fair enough if someone feels that way. I completely understand a lot of this behavior and stereotyping is not acceptable. But at some stage, someone has to say or be the bridge to try to explain that and try to educate that person and be prepared to have that conversation without getting, you know, pissed off yourself.
Yeah.
You know, even if you may be feeling it. So I've tried to always choose that route, you know, because what's the point of just going away angry?
Yeah, that's an excellent point, because getting upset at someone who's clearly done something wrong can feel cathartic in the moment, but then long term, as you said, that bridge hasn't been built, which is what the end goal is, right?
Yeah.
Is to form that connection so fewer things like that happen to people in the future as this person understands better. If you just yelled at that person and walked away, they would have said that to someone else 5 years from now.
Yeah.
with the same kind of view. So that patience is, you know, really impressive, because as you said, a lot of other immigrants will, you know, not have the patience to be that understanding.
And it's hard, because you don't want to always be the one that has to be the one who's understanding all the time. And
yeah.
I think that was what came out of the referendum debate we've had this year, that Indigenous people finally said, why do we always have to explain and always be the one to saying, holding out the hand and saying, welcome, 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 you know. And humour is a really important tool and weapon, as you would know, in these situations. And so it's not surprising that a lot of immigrant kids do develop a sense of humour, a way to use that to get themselves in and out of these situations. And it was unusual at the time, because I started a parallel role doing a lot of comedy shows at the same time I was doing serious news. So I'd do Good News Week and Glass House and, you know, with Paul McDermott and Will Anderson and all those shows, Andrew Denton, you know, Mikey Robbins. And it was unusual on two levels. First of all, I was a newsreader. No one really saw people in that role. And then, of course, obviously I was like the only brown face on Australian television as well. And there was this very funny moment on the show where a Channel 7 newsreading job had just come up. The person who'd been doing it long term had resigned. And in the media, there was some talk, who's going to replace this woman? And a few people had said, oh, you know, Indira would be good. And someone on the panel said, yeah, Indira, you know, you should take this job. And then someone else on the panel said, no, Indira can't take the job. She's, look at the colour of her skin. She's brown skin. They'd never give her the job, right? And he meant that, you know, that there's this unsaid racism that goes,
right,
goes on in some of the commercial networks. And the way I responded is I looked at put up my hands and I go, oh, my God, I'm brown. Oh my God, I had no idea, you know? which made everyone laugh, because the idea that you could not be aware of the color of your skin,
yeah,
obviously is a really funny thing, because
yeah,
how could you not know the color of your skin? But really, unless someone, you know, I actually don't, when I look at myself in the mirror, I don't see a brown person.
Yeah, unless you feel othered because of it, you're not
right,
aware of
I
it.
I just think, oh, look, I've got a Bondi tan. That's,
yeah,
you know, I've just been out in the sun. That's all it really is, right?
Yeah.
And I love turning the head on that just because other people think that this is a significant thing about you, why do I have to think it is? You might meet me and think, woman, brown, neither of those things is who I am. If you took away my brownness and being a woman, the essence of me would still be the same. I absolutely believe that. I could wake up tomorrow in a white man's body. It would be strange, but I think I could still carry on being me. you know, because the essence of me is not my skin color and it's not my gender.
Yeah.
I know a lot of brown women don't feel that way. A lot of brown women go, being a woman is really important to me, or being brown is my identity, and that's fine for them, but it's never been with me.
Yeah, that's fascinating. You'd wake up as a white man, you'd check your email and go, oh, look, I've got 7 dentistry offers from all around Australia. Everyone wants me to be a dentist now. no, but that is, it reminds me of the fact that when someone says, okay, you are this and you are this and you are this, that then makes people go, hey, hang on, there's 2 brown people on this show. That's going to be weird, isn't it? It's like, no, why though? Why? Why is it that, you know, like there'll be a quota of, okay, we'll have 1 brown person on this show, but then if there's 2, then that's going to throw everything apart. That's the same kind of thing. The other side of it, which it has that effect that people don't consciously realize.
Yeah, exactly. And there have been so many situations, you know, the two of us, when we presented a show recently on ABC, you know, 2 brown people, one of my last shows I did on SBS, 2 women were the hosts, hadn't been done before or seen before. And for me, who cares? That's really beside the point. It's what attitudes, you know, and strengths we bring.
Indira, it's been wonderful having you on and listening to your story. It's had, as you mentioned, as promised, so many different intricate waves and things that weave together. And a lot of times I was reflecting about my own experiences and annoyingly chiming in and going, hey, remember, I remember that from my life. And so I think we can all see a reflection of ourselves in these stories.
Yeah.
And so it's been wonderful to have you on. Thank you so much.
It's been a great conversation. Thanks so much.
Thanks for joining us. Our guest next week will be Anissa Nandaula. Born in Uganda and growing up in Rockhampton, Anissa is now a poet and comedian in Australia.